relief to the salaried taxpayers. The government has made many positive changes in the personal income tax rates applicable to the individuals in the last 3 years. Therefore, I do not propose to make any further changes in the structure of the income tax for individuals. There is a general perception in society that individual business persons are better, have better income as compared to salaries class. However, the income tax data suggests that a major portion of the personal income tax collection comes from the salaried class. For the assessment year 2016-17, 1.89 crore salaried individuals have filed their returns and have paid a total tax of 1.44 lakh crores, which works out to an average tax payment of rupees 76,306 per individual salaried taxpayer. As against this, 1.88 crores individual business taxpayers, including professionals, have filed their tax returns for the same assessment year period and paid a total amount of rupees 48,000, which works out to an average payment of rupees 25,753 per individual business taxpayer. In order to provide relief to salaried taxpayers, I propose to allow a standard deduction of rupees 40,000 in lieu of present exemption in respect of transport and reimbursement of miscellaneous medical expenses. However, transport allowance at enhanced rates shall continue to be available to differently abled persons. Also, other medical reimbursement benefits in the case of hospitalization for all employees shall continue. Apart from reducing paperwork and compliance, this will help the middle class employees even more in terms of reduction of their tax liability. This decision to allow a standard deduction shall significantly benefit pensioners also, who normally do not enjoy any allowance on account of transport and medical expenses. The revenue cost of this decision is approximately rupees 8,000 crores. The total number of salaried employees and pensioners who will benefit from this decision is about 2.5 crores. Relief to senior citizens. A life with dignity is a right every individual in general, more so for a senior citizen. To care for those who cared for us is one of the highest honors. To further the objective of providing a dignified life, I propose to announce the following incentives for senior citizens. Exemption of interest income on deposits with banks and post offices to be increased from rupees 10,000 to rupees 50,000, and TDS shall not be required to be deducted on such income under section 194A. The benefit shall also be for interest on all fixed deposit schemes and recurring deposit schemes. Raising the limit of deduction for health insurance and premium and medical expenditure from 30,000 to 50,000 under section 80D. All senior citizens will also now be able to claim benefit of a reduction of 50,000 per annum in respect of any health insurance premium and general medical expenditure incurred by them. Raising the limit of deduction of medical expenditure in respect of certain critical illness from rupees 60,000 in the case of senior citizens and 80,000 in the case of very senior citizens to rupees 1 lakhs in respect of all senior citizens under section 80DDB. These concessions will give extra tax benefit of rupees 4,000 crores to senior citizens. In addition to the tax concessions, I propose to extend the Pradhan Mantri Vaya Vandana Yojana up to March 2020 under which an assured return of 8% is given by the Life Insurance Corporation of India. The existing limit of investment of rupees 7.5 lakhs per senior citizen under this scheme is being increased to rupees 15 lakhs. The Government of India had endeavored to develop a world-class international financial centers in India. In recent years, various measures, including tax incentives, have been provided in order to fulfill the objectives. To further this objective, I propose to provide two concessions for IFSC in order to promote trade in stock exchanges located in the IFSC. I propose to exempt transfer of derivatives and certain securities by non-residents from capital gains tax. Further, non-corporate taxpayers operating in the IFSCs shall be charged alternative minimum tax at a concessional rate of 9% at par with the minimum alternative tax applicable to corporates. Further measures to control cash economy. Currently, the income of trust and institutions is exempted if they utilize their income towards the objects in accordance with the relevant provisions of the Income Tax Act. However, there is no restriction on these entities incurring expenditure in income in order to have audit trail of their expenses incurred in these entities. It is proposed that payments exceeding rupees 10,000 in cash made by such entities shall be disallowed and the same shall be subjected to tax. Further, in order to improve TDS compliance in these entities, I propose to provide that in case of non-deduction of tax, 30% of the amount shall be disallowed and the same shall be taxed. Rationalizing the long-term capital gains. Madam Speaker, currently the long-term capital gains arising from transfer of limited equity shares, units of equity-oriented funds and unit of a business trust are exempted from tax. With the reforms introduced by the government and the incentives given so far, the equity market has become buoyant. The total amount of exempted capital gains from the listed shares of units is around 3,67,000 crores as per return file in the assessment year 2017-18. Major part of this gain has been accrued by corporate and LLPs. This has also created a bias against manufacturing, leading to more business surpluses being invested in financial assets. The return on investment in equity is already attractive even without tax exemption. There is therefore a strong case for bringing the long-term capital gains from listed equities into the tax net. However, recognizing the fact that a vibrant equity market is essential for economic growth, I propose only a modest change in the present regime. I propose to tax such long-term capital gain exceeding rupees 1 lakh at the rate of 10% without allowing the benefit of indexation. However, all gains up to 31st January 2018, that is today, will be grandfathered. For example, if an equity share is purchased 6 months before 31st January 2018 at rupees 100 and the highest price quoted on 31st January 2018 in respect of the share is rupees 120, there will be no tax on the gain of rupees 20 if the share is sold after 1 year from the date of purchase. However, any gain in excess of rupees 20 earned after 31st January 2018 will be taxed at 10% if this share is sold after 31st July 2018. The gains from equity shares held up to 1 year will remain short-term capital gain and will continue to be taxed at a rate of rupees 15%. Further, I also propose to introduce a tax on distributed income by equity-oriented mutual funds at a rate of 10%. This will provide a level playing field across the growth-oriented funds and dividend-distributing funds. In view of grandfathering, this change, the capital gain will bring a marginal revenue of rupees 20,000 crores in the first year. The revenues in the subsequent years may be more. Health and education cess. Madam, at present there is a 3% cess on personal income tax and corporate income tax, consisting of 2% cess for primary education and 1% cess for secondary and higher education. In order to take up the needs of education and healthcare and BPL, I have announced in part A of my speech, to fund this, I propose to increase the cess by 1%. The existing 3% cess will be replaced by a 4% health and education cess to be levied on the tax payable. This would enable us to collect an additional rupees 11,000 crores. E-assessment. We had introduced an e-assessment for 2016 on a pilot basis, and in 2017 extended it to 102 cities with an objective of reducing the interface between the department and the taxpayer. With the experience gained so far, we are now to roll out an e-assessment across the country, which will transform the age-old system of procedure of the income tax department and the manner in which they interact with the taxpayer and the stakeholders. Accordingly, I propose to amend the Income Tax Act to notify a new scheme for assessment, whereby the assessment will be done in an electronic mode, which will almost eliminate any person-to-person contact, leading to greater efficiency and transparency. My other tax proposals on direct taxes are contained in Annexure 5. Indirect tax. On the indirect tax side, this is the first budget after the rollout of the goods and services tax. Excise duties to a large extent and service tax have been subsumed in the GST, along with the corresponding duties on imports. Hence, my budget proposals are mainly on the custom side. In this budget, I am making a calibrated departure from the underlying policy in the last 2 decades, wherein the trend largely was to reduce custom duty. There is a substantial potential for domestic value addition in certain sectors like food processing, electronics, auto components, footwear and furniture. To further incentivize the domestic value addition and make in India in these sectors, I propose to increase the custom duty in certain items. I propose to increase the custom duty on mobile phone from 15% to 20% and on some other parts and accessories to 15% and some parts of television to 15%. These measures will promote creation of more jobs in the country. Detail of changes made in the rates of customs as well as the changes made in the excise duty structure are given in the annexure to my speech. To help the cashew processing industry, I propose to reduce the custom duty on the raw cashew from 5% to 2.5%. I propose to abolish the educational cess and secondary higher educational cess and imported goods, and in its place impose social welfare surcharge at 10% on the aggregate of duties of customs and imported goods to provide for social welfare schemes of the government. Goods which were hereto exempt from educational sacks and imported goods will, however, be exempted from the surcharge. In addition, certain specified goods mentioned in Annexure 6 of my speech will attract the proposed surcharge at the rate of 3% of the aggregate custom duty only. I propose to make certain changes in the Customs Act 1962 to further improve the ease of doing business in the cross-border trade and to align certain provisions of the commitments under the Trade Facilitation Agreement to smoothen dispute resolution process and to reduce litigation. Certain amendments are being made to provide a pre-notice consultation, definite timelines for adjudication and deemed closure of certain cases if those timelines are not adhered to.